Chapter 10 is transition to adulthood. So this is coming out of adolescence and entering physiological adulthood. So adulthood actually begins with the ossification of the epiphyseal cartilage plates at the heads of the long bones. So once growth and height stop, that's when we're transitioned from childhood to adulthood. So this happens towards the end of adolescence. It's the entrance into the peak period. So physical strength, dexterity, and coordination peak about early 20s, right after entry into adulthood. And the sensory acuity peaks. And this is when aptitudes are really high. So, and aptitudes are enhanced by, that is, aptitudes for problem solving, arithmetic thinking, inductive reasoning, and the critical thinking all peak in early 20s. But it's dependent to some degree on how much work, that is cognitive labor and challenge, there was through adolescence. So there's, like the first 5 years, which is a critical period for several things like myelination of the brain and laying a foundation for the ability to engage in certain tasks, certain kinds of fine motor dexterities. There's a kind of a semblance, a critical period there in adolescence when aptitudes are very high, learning rate, fluid intelligence is at its near its max. And this is sort of the opportunity to lay a lot of foundation. So entering early adulthood can take advantage of all of that foundation that's been laid in adolescence. That's why, contrary to what we kind of see in public education, adolescence is actually the opportunity to really pour it on, it's also an opportunity to get kids caught up if they've had a deficient exposure earlier in childhood. So there's a lot of catching up that can happen. But how people progress through early adulthood and then go into the aging process is going to be affected by their childhood and adolescent experience. Now, when we enter adulthood, we actually transition from growth to aging. So there's this transition that begins the aging process. And the physiological aging is called senescence. And that takes into account several biological factors that are not independent of environmental factors. But these are the predispositions for aging. So you don't have to memorize all of this. It's a complex model. But senescence includes things like the genetic inherited predisposition, so that you can look at family history to kind of determine this. But aging is affected, rate of aging is affected a lot by how these physiological processes progress. So the big topic right now in the anti-aging literature is to look at chronic inflammation and exposure to certain toxins and things that can have an effect on the mitochondria and the chromosomal damage and DNA. And then also there's a lot of focus on nutrition and the sort of what's called the microbiome, which is your bacterial, good bacteria in the gut. There's a lot of focus on that. And that has to do with just dietary habits. And then finally, senescence, the input variables from the environment can also include what kind of activity or the level of activity a person's engaged in, what their aerobic health is, and some factors like this. And these are going to be becoming really important in looking at not only anti-aging, but disease prevention. It's an important topic, especially for nurses and nurse practitioners that have that time to spend with patients looking forward. and you know, seeing what kinds of disease or inflammatory processes they can prevent by changing habit patterns. This is the central topic in health psychology. So if you see somebody that's got habits that greatly increase inflammation in the heart or anywhere in the mediastinum, the lungs, the major vessels, like smoking, excessive calorie intake, really poor diet, alcohol consumption, and then of course even more toxic factors like other drugs like amphetamine, methamphetamine, things like that, that can have a dramatic influence on the aging process. So if we look at human longevity, we have to take the interactionist approach, that is the effect of environment and habit patterns on genetic predispositions. Family studies, twin studies, and longevity studies in families have found that only about 25% of the variation in human longevity is actually inherited. So what that leaves is a dramatic contribution from habit patterns and environment. You can look at this at a molecular level by looking at the identification of certain genes that have to do with the maintenance of the cell and its ability to continue to reproduce, because the maintenance of cell reproduction is at the cellular level the determinant of how fast we age. So that's called the aging phenotype. So you have a genetic predisposition that leads to an aging phenotype, which is how your cells maintain in a particular line, genetic line, how those cells maintain their ability to reproduce. Now, some of the things they've looked at are caloric restriction, which seems to be a real important habit pattern variant. And that is that they've done studies with low-calorie, ultra-low-calorie diets, or what's called an hypocaloric diet, where you line up the caloric intake with the metabolism of nutrients, like how efficient those calories are processed, those nutrients are processed into calories. And so certain foods are very efficient in how they're processed into nutrients, and they result in very few side chains or toxic components through the process of oxidation. So although there's no actual antioxidant that you can take, there are antioxidant or oxidation preventative practices, and hypocaloric diets or low calorie diets seem to be effective at reducing oxidation, and that enhances the maintenance of cell reproduction, which tends to delay the aging process. So epigenetic studies have shown that moderate regular activity and an active lifestyle can contribute quite a bit to delaying the aging process. And you can see that when you look at the world, where you see excessive longevity in certain parts of the world, and you can look at a combination of their diet and their lifestyle. Interestingly enough, people tend to live longer where you have mass transit. So that's attributed primarily to the fact that they just walk a lot more. If you've ever made a trip to the Northeast, up in, you know, New York City or those areas, or overseas to Paris or London, one thing that you have, that you're always told if you want to go there, is you need to take a very good pair of shoes because you do quite a bit of walking. Well, people in those environments, even though some of them don't have necessarily a great diet, they do tend to live longer and they have lower rates of heart disease. Interestingly enough, some Europeans smoke quite a bit, but still manage to have lower rates of COPD and heart disease than some people in the U.S. Also, if you track health in the U.S., you find that the further south you go, where you have less mass transit and more use of air conditioning, you have higher rates of type 2 diabetes, which is an inflammatory condition, heart disease, which is an inflammatory condition, hypertension, hypercholesterolemia, and arthritis, which are all inflammatory conditions. So inflammatory conditions in general are much more common in hot, southern environments where there's less mass transit and higher uses of air conditioning. Although I know, but I don't know about you, but I live in Fort Worth, but I would not give up my air conditioning. Now, specifically, we can look at the chromosome to figure out what is the sequence of genes that have to do with cell reproduction and ultimately aging, and that's the telomere, which is a repetitive nucleotide sequence on the ends of chromosomes. And this is the code that tells the cell to reproduce. So the longer the telomeres, which happens in early adulthood and childhood when you have high rates of cell reproduction, and that's what gives you resilience and plasticity. And so that gives you, results in increased reproductive capacity of these cells. Now, biological aging is a result of decline in telomerase, which is the enzyme that repairs these telomeres every time, or replaces them every time a cell reproduces. So the rate of replacement of the telomeres through telomerase is what helps maintain the cell. So one of the topics in cellular research having to do with aging is to look at factors that determine what maintains telomerase levels and consequently the length of telomeres and cell reproduction. Now, the main culprit in the aging process is inflammation. Of course, inflammation is the main culprit in almost all disease. Like heart disease is the result of inflammation of the vessels and the valves in the heart. Arthritis is inflammation in the joints. It's an overuse injury. Inflammation is the primary culprit in disease and in the aging process. So inflammation is an immune system function. It helps protect certain injuries and diseased organs whenever healing has taken place. When you have an infection and you run a little bit of fever, that's an inflammatory response that helps to combat the fever. That's why actually letting somebody have a little low-grade fever when they have a cold, they tend to get over the cold quicker, whereas suppressing fevers, overdoing that or overuse of over-the-counter medications for that can reduce inflammation, but it also can lengthen the cold. So your immune system kind of uses them. You can tell if the immune system is actually working by how much inflammation you have. A lot of people get disturbed when they have an influenza vaccine, for example, because sometimes you can have a low-grade fever and kind of feel punky and tired and a little sore after the vaccine. But that actually tells you that the vaccine's working. So it's not bad to have a little bit of a reaction to the vaccine. Some people believe because of that the vaccine actually gives them the flu, but that's not the case. It actually is an inflammatory response to the vaccine. But when inflammation is the cause of excessive kinds of injury or a bad diet or inflammatory inducing conditions like smoking, drinking, or things like that, then it becomes abnormal. And that can cause the deterioration of cells. And that's what results in the disease processes that we see that amp up the aging process. So chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, or COPD, is usually a product of smoking, or it's also found in people that work in environments with a lot of particulates in the air. Whenever people live in environments that are highly polluted, there's a lot of air pollution. I'm sure there's going to be a big ramp up of COPD in the West, in Oregon and Washington, where they're having and California, where they're having all the fires right now because the air quality is so bad. People with predispositions like asthma, which is an inflammatory condition causing constriction of the bronchioles and lungs, they're going to be more susceptible to an advanced case of COPD because of the air quality and some things like that. Psychological stress is a promoter of inflammation, and that's why you can see the response to stress in things like hypertension and hypercholesterolemia. In fact, stress is probably more likely to amp up your levels of low-density lipid proteins, which is bad cholesterol, as much as diet or being sedentary. So that's why stress management is a big topic in the health psychology literature. Other disorders that can result from inflammation that can cause a reduction in the ability to be independent and an early advanced aging is the effect of inflammation, implications for inflammation in Alzheimer's disease, carotid artery disease, which can cause vascular dementia, insulin resistance, which is type 2 diabetes, and of course, osteoarthritis, which can restrict movement. And then that can have implications because once a person has a lot of pain in their joints, then they're naturally less active. There's an operant there, and that is that to recognize in older folks that or athletes that wind up with osteoarthritis. And that is that when you do move or you try to move, you get punished for it by experiencing pain in your joints. What we know about humans is that any behavior that's punished gets reduces in frequency, intensity, or duration. So what happens is the person becomes naturally less active. Also, a person may tend to take NSAIDs, which like Prilosec and some of the, NSAIDs like ibuprofen and Aleve because those are anti-inflammatories. The problem is that they have an effect on the gut bacteria, and it can be a real dead end to take once you get on those protein pump inhibitors like Prilosec. It can be a real dead end as far as maintaining health because the short-term benefits become long-term processes that can result in even a worse condition later on. Now, some of the research is finding some interesting things about inflammation, and that is that the mediators of inflammation, these are the biological processes that help mediate inflammation in the joints and things like that, are sometimes enhanced by certain acute spells of stress, so physical stress. So it turns out that pushing somebody just a little bit beyond their comfort zone can actually result in less inflammation in the long run. And that's why I saw an interesting study where they found that if people sit for more than 20 minutes, they see inflammation levels go up. If people stay engage in some kind of vigorous activity, short-term it may result in immediate inflammation, but long-term inflammation goes down. So there's a plastic kind of response cycle that gets maintained if a person engages in some physical stress. So in other words, when we have to struggle a bit, we actually inoculate ourselves from the effects of inflammation by experiencing promoters of inflammation in the short run, but not long enduring types of inflammation. Just like short-term stressors are actually good for us, you know, it helps us manage normal kinds of short-term stressors. Enduring long-term stressors are not good for us because you have, you know, an exhaustion phase that sets in, and then that winds up leading to some problems like heart disease, hypertension, and other kinds of conditions like that. So big topics for health psychologists are, and ones that we had in my clinic, we used to do biofeedback, addiction treatment, smoking cessation, and stress management were some main processes that we handled, or strategies that we had in the clinic. And these were all designed, and obviously these operate in clusters. Like smokers are much more likely to be excessive alcohol consumers, or excessive alcohol consumers are more likely to be smokers. And also, smokers are much more likely to have dietary habits that are poor. Smoking actually enhances that to some degree, because chronic smoking suppresses your sensitivity to taste, which is gustation, and smell, which is olfaction. And so smokers tend to prefer fattier, less healthy foods because they can't taste fresh vegetables and things like that are real bland to them. Also, there's always the risk for cancer and other kinds of infectious diseases, because smoking and a really bad diet and being sedentary creates an immune response, and that immune response opens up a back door to infections. So smokers are much more likely to get pneumonia if they get the flu. So they're automatically in a high-risk category for this COVID-19. If you're a pack-a-day smoker, the COVID-19 coronavirus is much higher risk for that person, so they would be automatically in a high-risk category for getting advanced vascular inflammation in the lungs, which can lead to a serious case of pneumonia, and they can wind up on a ventilator. Their lung capacity is already low compared to non-smokers. So that's why health psychology has been introduced into the health promotion practices in many advanced kinds of medical settings. The effects of excessive use of alcohol are interesting, because it's actually the alcohol itself is not as toxic as the metabolites that come from it. So although alcohol is a denaturing chemical, the enzyme in your liver that breaks alcohol down is called alcohol dehydrogenase, and that converts alcohol to acetaldehyde. And acetaldehyde is pretty highly tissue toxic. So when acetaldehyde builds up in the bloodstream, which it does when you have a daily consumer, so like a person, you know, drinking a little too much once, their liver will clear the alcohol and the alcohol and the acetaldehyde, and they'll return back to normal. But you can have some overlap, because acetaldehyde is left behind after the alcohol is metabolized. So the real damage comes when you layer another dose of alcohol over the acetaldehyde that's left over in your system after the last dose of alcohol. So, you know, people that want to cure a hangover with, you know, a Bloody Mary with more alcohol in it, that's a monumentally bad idea. And so moderate, regular alcohol drinkers can really have an inflammatory response due to the acetaldehyde left in their bloodstream. And then what you do is you layer more alcohol on top of that, and that leads to a maintenance of high levels of moderate to high levels of acetaldehyde in their system. And that's where you get the real damage to the organ systems, kidneys, liver, heart, and brain tissue. Brain tissue is especially sensitive to acetaldehyde and can lead to what's called alcohol encephalopathy, which people that are moderate to high dose drinkers over a very long period of time, you'll start to see some pretty atypical motor movement in them, and loss of alertness and ability to retrieve information. I used to see cases when I was at John Peter Smith in the clinic across the street there. You see cases of alcohol encephalopathy in people that were actually, at that point, homeless and living on the street. And they would have sometimes signs of dementia, psychosis, and abnormal muscle movements and gait. You can see them sometimes when they're walking down the street, they have a real wide gait, they're real unstable. They used to call them punched, or they used to call them wet-brained. And those were people that appeared intoxicated all the time, even when they weren't. So let's look at nutrition and metabolism. Now, metabolism is naturally can decline with age, but it's maintained in more active people. So the more active a person is, the higher their metabolism is going to be, and the slope of decline in their metabolism due to just genetic aging is going to be a lot less. There's going to be less slope in their aging. So some of the things that cause a decline in metabolism, or the result of a decline in metabolism, can be an increase in body mass, and that's has to do with their weight divided by their height squared. So that would give you the body mass index. And when people's body mass index is greater than or equal to 25, then that's defined as a clinically relevant obesity. Many Americans have body mass indexes in excess of 25, and all kinds of problems result from a high BMI. Usually in a clinic, what you look at is their LD to HDL ratio. Low density lipoproteins are the hydrogenated fats and what's called bad cholesterol. These don't flow through the system very well, and you get plaque deposits, fatty plaque deposits in the lumens of the arteries, and this causes constriction in blood flow, especially in important areas like the arteries that supply blood to the coronary, heart muscle, and the vertebral arteries and carotid arteries that supply blood to the brain, and some of the arterioles up in the brain that supply blood to important parts of the brain. Now, high density lipoproteins are, that's what's called good cholesterol, and these are the ones that are oils at room temperature, like olive oil some of those, and they actually help clear some plaque because they solvate plaque, and at least lower levels of plaque, and help maintain circulation. Interestingly enough, when you look at people in parts of the world where they have lots of stable oils in their diet, fish oils and olive oil, they tend to have a lower incidence of heart disease caused by coronary artery constriction. So they also have a better HDL to LDL ratios. And so they're just generally healthier and have better circulation. You don't see as many problems with venous return and other circulatory problems. What we've done is in the pharmaceuticals, they've got what are called statins that can help reduce the buildup of low density lipoproteins in patients that don't respond well to dietary changes. Although in my experience, people are generally given statins independent of dietary changes, and so we don't always take advantage of the advantages of dietary changes. And this is where you can look at certain diets that have been very successful at reducing presence of low density lipoproteins in the system, and helping with weight loss and general health. Stephen Gundry and some of the other people that have looked into this have published what they call intensive care diets, where they can put people on sort of the ideal food regimen and activity regimen to get some of the same effects you'd get with medications. Let's look at intelligence in adults. One trend that you see is that in children, and all the way up to early adulthood, you see kind of a steady decline, gradual decline in neuroplasticity. It's greatest in very young children under age 5. And this is the degree of flexibility and cognitive functioning. So it's also, plasticity is related to aptitude. So the aptitude for acquiring at a rapid rate new motor skills, new cognitive skills is very high in early childhood. And their ability to recover from deficits like neglect or injury to the brain is a great deal better than it will be later in life. So intelligence in adults is multidimensional, which means that there are several types of mental abilities that we've talked about before. And you can see these in Gardner and Sternberg's models looking at different kinds of intelligence. So what happens is that the qualitative intelligence changes as we go through childhood and into adulthood. That is, young adults can take advantage of some of the work that was done when their aptitudes were really, really high, and their aptitudes are still pretty high, so they can take advantage of that aptitude, and so they have a lot of mental flexibility. So that makes intelligence multidirectional, which means that we don't get dumber with age, even though our aptitude does drop with age. So aptitudes related to fluid intelligence. This is how fast you can encode and retrieve information, utilize it, and it's going to start to decline with aging in early adulthood. So you're going to have a natural decline in fluid intelligence. It's a very, very gradual decline at first. And your decline in fluid intelligence is going to be highly dependent on aerobic fitness, activity, and exposure to novel stimuli. So when people are always learning new things, when they read, when they're interested in new experiences, people that seek out new skills, then they're going to be able to maintain their fluid intelligence much longer, although they will see some decline. It won't decline near as fast as somebody that's very sedentary and inactive. Crystallized intelligence, though, always builds. So the foundation for building crystallized intelligence is when your aptitudes are extremely high. So again, this is when in adolescence and early adulthood, if you really pour it on, you're laying on a really significant foundation, a schematic network, lots of information and experiences that build up expertise. Now that expertise can make it easier to learn new things because you've got a foundation of schemata that you can park that information on. So it's like building up a significant knowledge base. So that's where the more you know, the easier it is to know more. Now, crystallized intelligence, expertise tends to continue to build with age, and you don't start seeing declines in crystallized intelligence until late life. And even that is going to be determined primarily on how healthy and fit somebody is, or aerobic fitness, especially in late life. So you can see that crystallized intelligence can be categorized as secondary mental abilities, and it's built on the primary mental abilities, which mental abilities are much more aptitude-based. So social situations tend to be the experience-based that feeds into the ability to evaluate and think critically, and then building a vocabulary and semantic memory and knowledge base is what enhances verbal comprehension and reading comprehension. In fact, reading comprehension is highly dependent on knowledge base, something that we've gotten away from in education. A person's ability to read and comprehension is almost exclusively dependent on how much of a knowledge base and vocabulary they already have. And so the mechanics of reading aren't really near as important as the knowledge base that a person builds up as they're learning to read and through reading. And then ultimately those two things, the ability to evaluate and think critically and the knowledge base, are what gives you expertise in the secondary mental abilities that will keep a person functional into late life. Let's just look at the neuroscience of intelligence. And this becomes really important in understanding our ability to accumulate information and through our depth of processing. So this is called the parietal-frontal integration theory. And this came from functional MRI studies and PET scan studies, where they could look at the brain and what's happening when we're engaged in deeper level processing. So deeper level processing is when it's kind of that rabbit hole you go down when you're really interested in something. And it's the also when a person's teaching somebody something and they use analogies and examples and draw from their own experience, at that point they're processing at a very deep level. That's why the teacher often learns more than the student. I can tell you from 30 years of lecturing that I learn some connection in this literature that I've been teaching for a long time every single time I teach it, which is an advantage to being in the classroom, because whenever I'm talking to a class, it occurs to me at the time, many times I'll have just moments of insight, like, oh yeah, these two things are connected, while I'm actually talking to the class. And then, you know, having this discussion with the class about some of the information makes it much, much easier to remember. So that's why deeper level processing is so important for understanding and building a knowledge base, and why it takes precedent over memorization through repetition. Memorization through repetition is actually a very weak form of memory, whereas deeper level processing requires much less energy. That's why I've got you guys doing study guides, because when you're completing your study guides while you're reading the information, you are processing at a much deeper level. Even writing with your hand causes your motor cortex to process the information by creating language through a written document, and that is actually helps encode that information at a deeper level and give you more retrieval cues. So talking about it, discussing it, writing it down, experiencing it in some way, linking it to our autobiographical or episodic memory deepens the processing. That's why we do things like preceptorships and practica and internships. You know, medical students, for example, and nursing students learn a lot about medicine after they've laid the foundation by doing their internships and actually seeing these concepts in practice. So this is accounts for why we have qualitative difference in aptitudes in our intelligence, is because within general intelligence, which is Spearman's G, we have specialized abilities, and those vary from person to person. Just like many theorists, we see a stage theorist get to a certain point, like Piaget does with formal operations, which ends at the transition from adolescence to adulthood, actually ends with the entrance in adolescence and progresses through adolescence, is formal operations. And formal operations is when a person develops the ability to engage in inductive reasoning and abstract reasoning. But as what happens, you have one theorist come up with a model that gives you stages, and then someone will pick up the baton at that point, go on to develop the theory beyond that. And that's what King and Kishner did with formal operations when they devised the idea of post-formal thought. And so they describe post-formal thought as a development of reflective judgment. And so they give you three layers of reflective judgment, and which is advanced formal thinking. So pre-reflective reasoning is the first stage, the first set of stages. And this is the reliance on opinions of authority figures with little evaluation or evidence. So what you would say about people that are pre-reflective is that they don't have a strong ability for critical thinking. And that is they'll take what they hear at face value without skepticism. And so being skeptical is what gets you past the pre-reflective reasoning. Quasi-reflective is when somebody can acknowledge that there may be some uncertainty in what they're hearing or seeing, that they take it with a grain of skepticism and acknowledge that it may not be true because it is because of its face value. They apply that uncertainty to evidence, which gives them the ability to engage in some critical thinking. And they may not entirely trust the evidence. But quasi-reflective reasoning is just that acknowledgement that that things can come with a grain of uncertainty. Reflective reasoning, which is the highest level of King and Tischner's reflective judgment, is when judgments are made given sort of a best evidence, a preponderance of the evidence, like a civil court standard. They do an analysis of the evidence, they weigh the evidence, and they come up with a conclusion based on what the best evidence is, allowing for a certain degree of error. So reflective reasoning is the highest level of reasoning. Now, as you'll notice, many people never make it to being really good critical thinkers. They are not necessarily good reflective reasoners. Some are not necessarily good quasi-reflective reasoners. So some people take opinions just at face value. You'll notice that in the media, in the trades media, in cable television or internet sites, there are sites that give you information with some discussion of it as being evidence of something, and then there are sites that tell you what to think. And sites that tell you what to think are basically speaking to people that are pre-reflective and not to people that are quasi-reflective or reflective in their reasoning. Now you can see a relationship between King Tischner's reflective judgment and Lawrence Kohlberg's levels of morality. Pre-reflective reasoning is pre-conventional, which moral decisions are made to just avoid consequences, and they respond only to edicts and the threat of some kind of consequence or immediate reward coming from some authority figure. Quasi-reflective reasoners are more in line with Kohlberg's conventional morality, which is rule-governed morality. They are able to internalize and follow rules, but they may have some difficulty with a critical evaluation of the rules. Like there may not be any universal morality in the rules, so they may follow rules that would be not necessarily universally moral. Reflective reasoners coincide more with Kohlberg's post-conventional morality, and that is that they are functionally independent. They're able to critically think about rules and moral decisions and apply a basic sense of autonomous sense of morality to their decisions. So they can critically analyze moral authorities, and that gives them the ability to function autonomously. So emotional intelligence in adulthood, we've talked about this with kids, the ability of the frontal lobe after it develops to elicit control over the limbic system, which is the emotional system, or the ability to use cognition to control emotion. Keep in mind that emotion is always reactive. Cognition is the only brain structure function that can be proactive. So as frontal lobe function improves in adults, they are able to elicit proactive control over emotion or limbic function, that is, goal setting, or being able to inhibit impulses, or thinking about what happens next, what the long-term goals are. So people that are highly impulsive and less goal-directed tend to be lower in emotional intelligence. That's why, for example, in anger management, the goal is to help someone develop the capacity to elicit cognitive control over emotional impulses. That's why adults that have very poor anger control skills tend to be childlike in their responses. And they tend to be impulsive reactors to provocations. So the better someone is at being able to think past the moment and set a goal for how they want something to come out on the other side, that's a sign of high levels of emotional intelligence. So we try to improve emotional intelligence in people that don't have good skills at this. And that includes people that are addicted to substances, getting them to be more goal-directed and think past. One thing, like in smokers, for example, one cognitive technique with smokers is to teach them that cravings for cigarettes are temporary. Like the cravings come on in waves, and on the other side of the wave, the craving suppresses if you don't smoke. Also teaching them to think in advance and have some kind of a gate control device like Red Hots or Jolly Ranchers or carrot sticks or something that they can divert their attention to and divert their brain attention to in place of smoking. To get only with the idea of getting past the craving and on the other side of it. In suicide prevention, getting someone to see a grief reaction or depression or depressive state with anxiety as a temporary state, that your depression and a state of anxiety, it also comes in waves and subsides. And getting someone to think past that wave helps improve their emotional intelligence and helps them control their reactions to the provocation. And when you look at self-concept, self-concepts made up of course, self-image, self-efficacy, and self-esteem. And that gives us our sort of conceptual self, our self-schema. Marcus and Nurius looked at adult self-concept and defined three components that you have in adult self-concept. And that is our future representation of self, what we could become, and our future representation of self defined as what we're afraid of becoming. So we have a desirable future representation of self and a undesirable or avoidant future representation of self. And then we have the efficacious self, which is what we'd like to become. So that's our present self. They give us what you can become, what you would like to become, and what you're afraid of becoming. And with age, the emphasis on these three domains shifts. So you go from future representations of self to the present focused concerns like family and career and activities. And then your fear of what you're afraid of becoming involves mainly things like declines in health or abilities or financial stability with retirement. Now, personal control beliefs come in two types. Primary control, which is when a person's exerting control over environmental or world factors. This is problem-focused coping, trying to get past provocations and stressors induced by the environment to maintain adequate functioning. And then there's secondary control, which is what happens when you can't exert primary control. And this is called emotion-focused coping. This is the ability to adjust to adverse emotions when no solution is available. Getting through a divorce, losing a job, having financial problems that are not that are not the product of a person's own decisions. Getting diagnosed with a serious condition like type 2 diabetes or heart disease.
There's no way to take that away or change the past. So you have it. Now, what are you going to do about it? That's emotional focused coping. This is a big topic in health psychology because emotional focused coping is improved by stress management and changing your attributions. I saw this in people when I was in the Army that were traumatic amputees, the ones we saw in the war in Iraq. And that was this transition from what have I lost to what do I have left. I saw that in many of them that had lost a leg or both or an arm. They would at first be traumatized by the loss and they'd be focused on the things they're not going to be able to do and feel kind of hopeless that they won't be able to cope. But then you see this transition happen as they start to go through rehabilitation and heal and get into the prosthetics program and things like that, and they start focusing more on what I lost. I had a couple of cases, for example, athletes who had been real competitive and then would lose a limb. One guy lost both legs and he was an athlete. And when he went through the prosthetics program at Walter Reed, he got real into the titanium wheelchairs and the learning how to use the high-tech prosthetics. And he started talking about competing in the competitions for athletic competitions for people with disabilities. So he had just shifted his focus from what he lost to what he had left.